Йо, привет, привет. Я Геннадий Самоковаров и я не говорит по-русски. I know, with my name it may be surprising, but I don't speak Russian at all. I'm Геннадий Самоковаров, this is how I look online. You can find me on Twitter at gsamokovarov, I tweet about tech, and on GitHub at gsamokovarov, I have some open source, you can check it out. I work for a company called Receipt Bank, and again, with the names, we're not a bank, we're actually developing bookkeeping software, we're extracting data out of receipts, and we're saving bookkeepers and accountants a lot of time. I'm from Bulgaria, this is why I don't speak Russian. Yeah, so Bulgaria is right here. This is southeastern Europe, you know, not eastern Europe, it's very different. We invented the Kyrillic alphabet, so although I don't speak Russian, I can get my way around the city and read the schedule, some of the tooling. I can get my way around the city. You may know Bulgaria because of our seaside. It's pretty popular, or at least we have this impression with you. So if you ever want to go to our seaside, don't go to Sunny Beach. It's not good. Go to Sinemorets. This is water. This is the river Velika. It flows straight into the Black Sea, and you have this beach with the river on one side and the sea on the other. It's pretty cool. I live in Sofia, and Sofia is a really cool city. And if you're looking for an excuse, you know, to visit it, I also run a conference called Balkan Ruby. This year, next year, we're going to have our third event, and for it we have Mats on board, Charles Nutter of JRuby, and Akira Matsuda of RubyKaiGi fame. Our call for papers is open, and if you want to apply, we do cover the expenses of all of our speakers. So you can come to Bulgaria. So enough about Bulgaria. This is my first time here in Russia and in Moscow, and I'm not going to lie to you, I did came with all those stereotypes in mind. You know, I watch a lot of Only in Russia videos, so I was expecting crazy stuff, no bears, no tanks on the middle of the road, nothing like this happened. No vodka either, nobody was drinking vodka in the bars that, except us. I had to do it, nobody was drinking vodka. Semichki, we like semichki in Bulgaria, nobody has this. Nobody eats this. No biohazard, nothing. Like, Moscow is sparkling clean. I don't know how you guys do it. Nobody was cutting, you know, so I had to do it on the video. Nobody else did it. Yeah, so, but on the, and of course, communism, very popular in Bulgaria, older age back in the days. No sense of it. I went to GUM, and it was like the pinnacle of the capitalism. All the modern shops and so all of my perceptions about Russia has been completely wrong. And on a more serious side, everybody has been so nice to me, and I really appreciate all the work that the organizers of Ruby Russia have done so far. And 10 years, it's an amazing achievement for a conference, so thank you guys, keep up the good work. So my talk is called Break, and Break is a debugger written in plain Ruby. Okay, so this talk is about a debugger, but this talk is also about more than a debugger. This talk is about this idea that I have, and the idea is that if you write our Ruby toolings in Ruby, this is a good thing, this is a virtue. So if we need to write our debuggers in C, maybe we can change the language a little bit, so it gives us all the utilities so we can write it in Ruby. If we write our debugging tools in Ruby, they can be portable across VMs, so Break can run on JRuby, and I think this is a great thing. And overall, I'm a Ruby programmer, I enjoy writing Ruby, and I really want to do more Ruby myself. And this talk is my love letter to Ruby, and how we can use it more. Okay, so the plan for the talk is the following. At first, I'm going to be talking about debugging, what is debugging, what kind of tools do we have at our disposal at the moment. Then I'm going to look at how those tools came to be, a little bit of history about them. And then I'm going to be talking about the current debugging APIs we have, and maybe the debugging APIs I wish for us to have. And finally, I'm going to be talking about Break, which is implementation for those ideas that I have. Okay, so What is debugging? What is a debugger? According to Wikipedia, this is a tool, debugging tool, that is used to test and debug other programs. So it's a very loose definition, right? It's not something super strict. And a debugging tool. What is the first debugging tool we ever reach? What do I do when break breaks? I print. Puts is a very valuable debugging tool. It's maybe the first tool we reach from. And it's cool. It works very well in Ruby. There is this very nice article by Aaron Patterson in which he declares proudly that he is a Puts debugger and gives you all those tips and tricks on how to debug more efficiently, just printing stuff. And Ruby is a dynamic language. We can query a lot of information in the runtime, and it's nice. But when the Puts debugging starts to break down is when you start making mistakes here and your Puts is breaking, or you're looping and just printing a lot of useless data. So maybe the next tool that we have is something like Pry, binding Pry or binding IRB. Recently we got this in the standard library. And while this is cool, it lets you introspect your program when you stop it. It does not give you the ability to progress the program, you know, say, go to the next line, step into this function. For this, we need debuggers like dbase or bybug. So those are the real debuggers. And why they are real debuggers? Well, they interrupt the debugged program. They give you control over its execution. And they let you do a few interesting operations. They let you step into method calls. They let you step out of method calls, step over method calls. They let you go to the next line that will be executed in a way. So you have this nice repo, but you also have control over the execution of the program when you need it. Holy moly. Okay, so let me show you how bybug works for those of you that never used it. So to start bybug, you just require bybug and says bybug somewhere in your program, and your program stops, and it says, you're right here. And what you can do is say, OK, I want to go to the next line. And you don't go to the next physical line. You go to the next line of code that Ruby will actually execute. So you can navigate this program. Here we're just in definition, function definitions. We can do nothing. But here I can step into this method call. And once I step into this method call, I can say, oh, what is the result now? Okay, I can step over this, I can step into this block, I can step into this function execution, I can say, oh. So I can introspect a lot of stuff, and I can continue my program execution. So how those debuggers came into existence? How did we get to debuggers like bybug or dbase? Well, it all started with debugRB. Just as a little experiment, how many of you have heard about debugRB? Okay, this is actually more people than I expected. So debugRB is a debugger that's in the standard library. This is a debugger that comes with Ruby for quite a while now, more than 20 years, actually. So to use it, you have to require it somewhere in your program, like this, require debug, which is nice. This debugger is available everywhere. What is not so nice about it is its user interface. Let me show it to you. This is its user interface. It's heavily inspired by GDB. So it just shows you this current line of code. It starts with a warning. It hasn't been maintained that much during the recent years. But you can use it. It's actually pretty useful. It can do the same things that bybug can do for most of the cases. You can step into functions. You can introspect stuff. It's nice. It works. Although it just crashes when you exit. So this is the sad thing about it. It's user interface. It's not well maintained anymore. And how do you even invoke it twice in a program? You started by requiring it. You can only require a library once. You have to poke to its internals to figure this out. And its last significant commit was 6 years ago. It's been a while. It's been a while. But it's implemented with this API. This is the debugger written only in Ruby, so it's possible. Bybug break is not special in any way for it being written only in Ruby. this particular debugger is written with our oldest tool that we have for implementing such things. This is called the kernel set tracefunc. So let's look into how we can use kernel set tracefunc. So kernel set tracefunc is a function that lets you attach a proc that the VM will call on significant events. Okay, here is how we use set tracefunc. We give it a procedure. This procedure accepts some arguments. The one that we are most interested in here is probably the event. So this is the type of event the VM called us on. We have various events. For example, the call event is invoked every time when we invoke a Ruby method. The class event is invoked every time we open class or module. The end event is when we close a class or module. On the line event, it's executed. This event is invoked on every line of code. You can hook on this event and write like code coverage tools, for example. You can know when an exception is raised and all these nice ways, nice things. So, okay, we have this this utility. We have kernel set tracefunc. So then why is the base and why is Bybook written in C? Right? There has to be a reason. And the reason is performance. kernel set tracefunc is slow, and it's slow. This slowness comes from its API even. The procedure is invoked for any event. You're not subscribing to events. You have to switch on this event. And for every event, we are building a binding object. Binding objects in Ruby, they represent like stack frames, and they're very heavy to build. They're slow to build. And those objects are built on every event, even if you don't care about it, and you're going to discard it. Even more, you see, the event names are strings. So every time you allocate strings for every event. So kernel set tracefunc is slow. And it's kind of deprecated for a more modern TracePoint API. So the TracePoint API takes on the idea of kernel set tracefunc, but overcomes some of its shortcomings. It provides an object-oriented API, so it's a bit easier to use. But more importantly, it can only listen to specific events. You don't need to switch on events anymore. You can say, listen only to those events. You can easily stop it. This is also important, so you don't slow down the program when you don't need to. And this API is available in both Ruby and in C. Okay, so here is an example on how you can use TracePoint. You require TracePoint, this is a constant. The class method trace creates you a new TracePoint object that listens only for those events, line, call, and return. This is an if example of the step over command, how you can do it in the debugger. And you can say, okay, if this is a call event, collect me the frame and increase me the depth of the debugging context. If you're returning from a function, pop the last frame and decrease me the depth of the function. And every time the depth is not near zero, just discard this. I'm not interested in this line. But if the depth is zero, disable this trace. This is very important for performance. And change me the debugging context. Like, this is how TracePoint looks. It supports a lot of events, all the events that kernel set tracefunc supports, like the line event, the class event. We can know whether a C function was called, whether a C function returned, when exception was raised, when we opened the block, when we closed the block. We can use it even to synchronize threads. So if we need to do thread synchronizations in our debuggers, we can do that. We can use a TracePoint for this. Okay, but how did TracePoint came to be? Well, it all started with this debugger called RubyDebug. So RubyDebug is a fast implementation of the standard Ruby debugger, DebugRB. It's a very old debugger. It's for Ruby 1.8 and Ruby 1.9. And it was started by JetBrains. So the Russian community has developed all the current debuggers that we have in Ruby. So thank you guys for that. And let me tell you its story just by looking at its repository. So for Ruby 1.8, we had this repository. We didn't have any debugging APIs, so what RubyDebug did was it imported the unexported headers of every Ruby installation, and it poked inside the Ruby internals. In Ruby 1.9, we got a brand new VM, so all of the 1.8 implementation had to be thrown away. So it was forked and rewritten for 1.9. For Ruby 2, again, the internals changed so much, so somebody had to fork it, and they weren't able to get it to work for Ruby 2. Then Quichi, of all the people, forked this fork, coded debugger 2, and made it kind of work in Ruby 2. It's all written in C. And then JetBrains picked this project again, rewrote it for the third time, called it Debase, and this is how we got the modern RubyMine Debase debugger. And cool anecdote, Buyback is actually based on some version of Debase's code. It's not an official fork. David just copy-pasted the Debase's code and built a repo on top of it. And all those tools relied on gems like this one, Debugger Ruby Core Source. This gem, all it does is it copies the unexported headers of every Ruby, of every released Ruby installation. So if you wanna use internals, you can use unexported headers for your C API gems. So it's, as you can see, just depending on unstable APIs and stuff like C APIs, it's hard. I think the changing internals are what killed those debuggers. And the TracePoint API is a single API that solves most of the problems that RubyDebug had throughout its years. And yeah, writing debuggers back in the days when we didn't have the TracePoint API was way harder than it is today. So what, besides TracePoint, what other debugging APIs do we have in Ruby? So another reason why you want to use C in your debugger is because there are things that you cannot do in plain Ruby. For example, postmortem debugging. Postmortem debugging is when you want to debug a crashed program. And when you want to debug a crashed program, it doesn't mean that you have to debug your crashed Ruby. Maybe you want to debug your crashed Rails application. What you want to do is pry open the stack frame at this particular point of time, and there is no way to do that in pure Ruby. We have some way to some APIs to represent the current stack frame. This is kernel color. It more or less produces the backtraces of the exceptions. But this API is just read-only. You can more or less visualize your stack frame, your stack, but you cannot change it in any way. We have another API called kernel color locations, which is a bit better than kernel color because instead of an array of strings, it returns us an array of threadback trace location objects. So if we want to know which method code is, we can at least not parse strings and use methods, which is still a bit better, but not enough. Both of those APIs are read-only and they are only for presentational purposes. If you want to pry open the stack frames, we don't need to do any unauthorized stuff. We have an official C Ruby API for that. It's called Debug Inspector. It's in Ruby until from Ruby 2, something like this. And this API lets you pry open the current VM stack frames and build binding objects for at least the Ruby stack frames. It's C Ruby specific. This is the problem, and it's only available in C. It's only available in C, but it's a very high-level API. Here's how it works. You want to say, okay, debug inspector, open me the VM, and you attach it a callback. This callback gets called with this initialized struct, and you can take this struct, you can say, okay, give me the backtrace locations of it, and from the backtrace locations, we can get a binding. So here's how it works. If you want to extract the current bindings, like the bindings for the stack frames that we can do it like this. We can call the RB debug inspector, open, give it this callback, and say, okay, give me the locations from this struct, and for every location, try to get me at the binding. If you cannot get me the binding, you're probably in the C frame, and that's okay. And just collect them. It's in C, but it's super simple to use. So here's what I'm thinking. TracePoint is a very high-level API for debugging purposes. It just calls you. You don't Cripon registers, program counter, stuff like this. The debug inspector, even if it's written in C and it's available in C, it's still a very high-level API. So why don't we just expose it to Ruby? So there are a couple of attempts to do that, actually. One of them is called the debug inspector gem, and it exposes the debug inspector API like one-to-one to Ruby. You can find its implementation here, and what it does is it just gives a Ruby interface to the C API. It's nothing fancy, it's more or less exact replica of the C API. Well, so this is nice, but if you want to use it, you're running into a problem. Exactly. My point exactly. Let me show it to you. Okay, so I'm the maintainer of a debugging tool in Rails called Web Console, and it's a debugging tool that appears every time your program crashes. So every time your program crashes, there is this little console right here. I don't know if you see it. And I can debug stuff. And even more, just this I cannot do it with pure Ruby. What's the harder thing is that once this exception happened, I was able to collect the stack frame and just and I'm able to change the context of this debugger. So over here I have access to the request in a way. And for this mapping, I have to map the stack trace with the extracted bindings in the Ruby application code, because I'm not sure that there are no like C frames in the mix taken. So you have this problem. It's okay, you can do your job, but it's annoying. Another attempt to solve this was binding of core, again by the same guy. This is the guy who created Pry. Binding of core has the following interface. So we are monkey patching the binding object, and you can say, okay, give me the color of the current stack frame. So in this example, if I call method A, which calls method B, which declares a local variable, calls method B, and method B calls C, in C I can say, okay, give me the binding of, not this one, but this core, and change its local variable. And at the end, I'll just print hello, not 10. So this API still works, but again, we have the mapping problem that we have with just the direct way of exposing the debug inspector API. So the API that I think will serve us best is if we are able to somehow attach the binding method to the threadback trace location object. This API is suggested by Tom Enebo of JRuby in RubyKaigi 2018, and it looks like this. We have the standard color location to get our backtrace, and in the backtrace itself we have the binding method. Maybe we need to pass a keyword to say, okay, extract me the binding, if we cannot do that lazily. But this is the API. This way, for example, if you have like an optimized frame, that frames like you have in JRuby or Truffle Ruby, or maybe now with the JIT in CRuby as well, the binding can be just new to indicate such cases. And if you have C frames as well, the binding can be new. This is in the contract of the API. This is nice. But what we get here is that we don't need to map a traceback to, you know, a binding. So this is the API that I think that we should use. And the nice thing about it is it's like it will be an unofficial API that can be implemented by the VM maintainers, you know, not by us. And stuff like debuggers can become more or less UX work. Most of the heavy lifting is already handled by the TracePoint API or the debug inspector API. So the pros and cons of this approach is, well, the cons of exposing any such API at the moment is performance. You know, creating binding objects is very slow. And also dangerous operations. If you remember the example from binding of cover, I was able to modify the code of my parent frame. Which is what the debuggers do. but the pros are that we can have portable debugging tools, and we can increase the adoptions of the alternative VM implementations if we can carry our debugging tools with them. So I opened a book on the JRuby tracker, trying to sell that, and say, you know what, we need this API. I'm not very specific which one we will take, but at least we need something like this so I can rewrite web console in Ruby only. And Quitch was like, I don't like that. This is the current situation. But a month ago, the core team kind of discussed it, and maybe we can have a solution. Who knows? Okay, so we talked about all those debugging KPIs, and we still haven't seen like any real implementation of them. What is Break, and why does it matter? So Break is an implementation of all those ideas I have about debugging KPIs, debuggers, debugging KPIs, and how maybe we can write a debugger in pure Ruby. So Break is written only in the TracePoint API. No, in plain Ruby, there is no Fido, there is no FFI. It kind of wears the Ruby-only label with pride. You know, if I'm not able to support postmortem debugging because I don't have a Ruby API to do it, I won't support postmortem debugging. I won't be able to go up and down the stack frame. I'll be okay with that as well, as long as I can implement features only with Ruby. So yeah, if Ruby doesn't have an API for that, Break won't support it. Plain and simple. But what Break gives you is basic execution control handling of your debugged program. You can step into a method, you can step out of a method, you can step over a method like by bug. And furthermore, Break doesn't even have its own front end. If you've noticed, Bybug has a nice UX, but not as nice as Pry. And people are using Binding Pry and Binding IRB. So Break just extends Binding IRB and Binding Pry and gives you the next step, the next in-step commands. So let me show you how Break works. Can you all see that? Holy shit. So this is a regular Binding IRB debugging session, except that now you can go to the next one with the next command. So I can go over the definition of the functions. I can step into this method call. See, I can see, okay, what's the result now? I can step over this, I can step into this this block. See, it's still not as good as Bybug, but we're getting there. So, as you can see, this is a TracePoint limitation. This line is just discarded from Ruby. So you can continue with your program, and it will kind of work. Cool, so the next thing that you actually have is the Pry support. So if you're using Pry, and all you need to do is just require Break. And again, you have all those commands that you want to do. You can exit this session and go into the to the next breakpoint. You can go to the next one, you can step into this. So Break doesn't introduce itself in any subtle way. If you use Binding, if you use IRB, if you use Pry, you can just use it. And I think it's kind of cool. And even more, let me just show you something. If you try the Ruby 2.7 preview, you see that IRB itself has been pimped a little bit. Now we have colors. You have syntax, how I think it's a bit more pleasant experience, IRB in Ruby 2.7. So again, Break works very well with that. I don't need to build my own UX and kind of compete with IRB or Pry. I can just work with them. So here's how Break is implemented, just from over the top. So every time we want to debug something, we create a context debugging session. The debugging sessions, the context debugging. So the context has bindings and depth. This is all we collect. Every context is attached to a session, and the session controls the front ends it can attach and detach front ends of it for each debugging session. And stuff like the next command are implemented like this. Listen for the following events. So every time you step into a method call or a class definition or whatever creates stack frames, collect the binding and increase the depth. Every time you return from a function, pop the binding and pop the depth. So if you're somewhere around zero, you can stop your program. This is your next step, and you can change your context. Plain and simple. Every trace point command is started only when it's needed, and it's stopped when it's reached target. So there is no unneeded tracing if you don't want to debug. So just requiring a break won't make your program slower because we're not tracing anything. And because break is written in Ruby, we have a filtering mechanism to discard any Ruby code that's coming from break itself, or from IRB itself, or from pry itself. This is how the step command is implemented. Here we're acting on the call event every time we call a method, every time we open a class or call a block. We disable the trace and change the context. We're also acting like step over because it's a good user experience to just go to the next line if there are no method calls. And you can try break with gem install break. This is where it's hosted on GitHub. It's still in its early days and it's kind of broken, but if you're interested, you can help me fix it. And this is it. Thank you so much. Okay, so I think we have time for questions.
Yeah, we have a lot of time for questions. So, questions. Okay. Okay. I'll be right with you.
So debug.rb is currently implemented with setTraceFunc, as you said. And are you interested in replacing the implementation with the TracePoint version, like just replacing the library entirely with the current break gem?
I don't know. I could be, but it's just it's a lot of work.
Yeah. So the debug.rb is currently unmaintained, so currently we are kind of searching the mainer, and maybe you would be a best person to take over the mainer, possibly.
Cool. I can check it out. I used to study it for a break, but yeah. We can do that, but I'm even more interested in how we can make people use it, use debuggers more, so that's why I thought that shoving break right into IRB or pry is like a good idea because people already use it and we don't need to change their habits. But okay, I can look into debugger.rb and get in touch with you.
Thank you. And the best part of this is that some commuters want the debugging functionality in IRB by default. So if once the debug.rb is replaced to break.rb, I guess maybe you can have the IRB integration in the debug.rb, and we can have the debugger functionality in a very standard environment, and that would be nice.
For example, we can even change IRB because right now there is no way to have like proper commands. All the commands are methods. Mm-hmm. So the next command, I had to hack it because next is a keyword and just next is a syntax error. Mm. You cannot use next, and I had to hack it for a little bit. Yeah, so.
Thank you.
Cool. Thank you. So.
Thank you. That was a very good question and a kind of proposal. Okay, we had a question over there. Okay. Well, Gennady, thinking of re-implementing debug.rb, I'm running.
No, and break is still kind of broken.
Debug.rb either, so that's not a problem.
Yeah. Hi, I'm just wondering, is there a way to set a breakpoint in a different file? For example, if I want to set a breakpoint in a gem without writing binding.rb in the source file?
Not right now, but you can actually start at trace point and listen for, you know, the line event and the file name, and you can stop it over there. It's just not implemented. It's completely possible to. So Truffle Ruby have very nice support, very nice debugging support, and their front end is the Chrome browser, the Chrome DevTools. I think this can be the natural next step for Ruby, the Ruby debuggers, because we have this very nice UX in the browser, and you can set trace points and everything in Ruby file. So yes, we can. It's not yet implemented. You can help out.
Okay.
Thank you for the talk. Excuse me if I missed it, but do you have any bridge, like any adapter to swap the front end for Break? For instance, add the adapter to make a Ruby mine front end for Break.
Sure, sure. I have such mechanism. It's you can open the source code. Like both IRB and Pry have their own front end, so it's just like this little interface that we can do. For making an adapter for RubyMine, maybe we need to have an ongoing thread or something like this serving it, but for sure, it's something that we can do. Again, it's not yet implemented, but maybe if there's enough interest, we can do it.
More questions? Okay. Oh. Please stand up.
Black Gudaria for the talk.
Oh, thank you for listening.
How did you use IRB? No, wait, Pry, and you have front end for Pry and for
IRB.
IRB. How did you use the reuse the front end and exchange the debugging code?
Okay, so this is this kind of hack. So the TracePoint API kind of calls you asynchronously, so it lets you your code runs. So when I need to stop, I say okay, exit. Detach the IRB session, which is this hacky way to exit it. Okay. And once I exit it, I go to the next place I have to go and start a new binding IRB session. So that's how. So next exits the IRB session. Let me show you. So when I say next, this will first it will exit the IRB session. Uh-huh. It will create a trace point. It will create a tracing. It will exit the current session, and when the trace point resolves, you know, I have to go to the next line. Here, create me the new context. It will actually start a new binding.irb.
So by binding.exit, you kind of suppress the original behavior of the front end of IRB.
I'm not that much plugging into IRB. I'm using IRB under the hood.
Yeah, but that's what I'm asking. Like, how do you use the front end, like the formatting and everything, but.
It's a hack. I basically start IRB on every command.
Okay.
It's not like...
Ingenious. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. Okay, we don't have any more questions, but I want to ask a follow-up regarding this question of breaking commands. So, wouldn't it be slow if we create a trace point looking for a line event and wait for it eventually to hit?
Yeah, I'm not sure. It could be. Very well could be. Because the current architecture is, you don't have any tracing until you say next or step. So you don't have any overhead by just requiring break. There are no trace points going in the background. And I think this is nice. But stuff like breakpoint support, there is no way. You have to have a long running trace point for them.
Yeah, maybe. Just thinking. Alternative solution could be if we limit this functionality only to methods, so just breaking by class name and method name, maybe we can just inject binding IRB into this method and make it lightweight, avoid trace points, and just start the session as soon as we hit this method. What do you think?
Or I don't know, if you have the when you say breakpoint, maybe then you can start the breakpoint for the line that you need, and when it resolves, you start
no, not just line, just the beginning of the method. Yo, we won't be able to start the line, so probably we will, but that's just injecting this code, like module prepend, super, whatever, binding IRB inside, and that would be a way to avoid trace points, long running trace points, but making it still debuggable, maybe not just a particular line. If you had a method with 100 of lines of code, but well, you've anyway. But if it's just a small method, this could be kind of easier workaround probably.
Yeah, we can
with lower overhead because a line event is kind of a huge overhead. I think could be for some cases. Yeah,
it could be. Yeah, I haven't tested it, so I don't have enough information.
Okay, so thank you, Gennady, one more time.
Thank you so much, folks.